This afternoon, I would like to present some of our work on modeling growth and form and corals and the analysis of three-dimensional images. I would like to summarize the kind of topic on which we are working in our group in Amsterdam. So we are very interested in the whole issue, how you get growth forms from the genetic information. And the current idea in developmental biology is that you have somewhere the genetic information, which is translated into gradients of morphogenes. And this leads to all kinds of biomechanical actions, like, for example, growth of cells, cell migration. And together with environmental influences, this finally leads to a certain kind of growth form. And we are very interested to understand this process by using a combination of experimental observations and simulation models. Now, for this purpose, we are using a kind of multi-scale modeling approach. And we currently working in our group at all kinds of different levels of organization. At the lowest level, we are currently very interested in trying to develop methods for predicting gene networks starting from genome sequences. We also put a lot of effort in developing methods for modeling spatiotemporal gene expression patterns. We use, for example, in situ hybridization, but also transcriptomics data. And we use as examples the C. anemone, Nematostella affectensis, and the coral Acropora millopora. We are currently also working on modeling cell movement during early embryogenesis. One level higher, we are currently also putting a lot of effort in understanding biomineralization, for example, calcification in corals. So recently, we also did a lot of work on the proteomics, about the proteins involved in the calcification process. We also recently published a few papers about this topic. One level higher, we are very interested in understanding the physiology, for example, the physiology around calcification and how it's, for example, linked to photosynthesis. Finally, we also look at a more microscopical level of the growth process, and we try to understand how a certain kind of growth form is emerging and how it's interacting with the physical environment. And then you should, for example, think about hydrodynamical processes and light. And finally, we also work on a kind of microscopical level in which we compare morphologies with each other. And we use this for comparing different coral species and also compare this with, for example, trees, which result from a kind of genetic comparison between those different species. Now, I would love to present all of this work summarized on this slide. Unfortunately, I will need more than this afternoon to present everything. So I have made a kind of selection. So this afternoon, I will give a few examples of the light blue topics. So I will talk a little bit more about the microscopical model. And tomorrow, on Friday, I will give a few examples about the yellow topics. And I will tell something more about modeling gene regulation and modeling the biomechanics of cells. And finally, the kind of thing what we hope to do is we want to develop models on all these different levels. And finally, we would like to couple everything together, and hopefully somewhere far in the future, we hope to understand everything about growth and form. Now, here you see a picture of one of our pet organisms. This is a picture of the Australian coral Acropora millopora. The special thing about this coral is that it's one of the corals which has been sequenced, and also the developmental biology of this coral is pretty well known at this moment. In this picture, you see again a picture of Acropora millopora, and you see another picture of one of the organisms which we are using as a case study, which is the C. anemone Nematostella affectensis. So over here, you see the life cycle of both organisms. It starts with the fertilized egg cell. You have a number of cell divisions. Over here, you have the gastrulation process. Then you have the formation of a free-swimming planula larvae. And finally, you have a kind of polyp stage. And in fact, in the coral, almost the same thing happens. The only difference between this organism and this organism is that this organism is calcifying. So the genetic comparison between both organisms is very interesting because potentially you can find the genes involved in calcification. And by the way, both organisms are known as entozoans, and they are considered as very basal organisms. And probably I don't have to show such a kind of slide for this kind of audience, but over here you see an overview of the animal kingdom. So in fact, the y-axis is a kind of axis of complexity, and in this talk we are focusing on the basal organisms, which belong to the cnidarians. And they are along this axis of complexity, they are at the bottom of the animal kingdom. And from a kind of computational point of view, this is very attractive because they have a relatively simple body plan, and it's relatively easier to build simulation models for this kind of body plan. Originally, we also had the idea that the whole gene regulation was pretty simple in these kind of organisms. This was a kind of speculation which we made maybe 10 years ago, but after a few years, we already discovered that also in these organisms, the gene regulatory networks are relatively pretty complex. And maybe another good reason to study these animals is that they're simply beautiful animals, but that's not the usual thing which you write down in a grant proposal. Now if we zoom in on a piece of coral, so over here you see a dead coral, so all the living tissue is removed. Over here you see a surface view of a living coral, and you see that these cups, the so-called corallites, are filled with this kind of polyps, and they're covering the skeleton. And over here you see a diagram of one individual polyp. It's in fact a kind of small sea anemone. And over here you see a section to the wall of the polyp, and the green dots which you see over here are the symbionts, the dinoflagellates, which are taking care of the photosynthetic process in a coral. So the coral can also use light as an energy source. And you can see that it's sitting on top of this skeleton. So only the outer surface of the coral colony is alive. Then to understand the growth of a coral, that's a typical multi-scale problem, and that's illustrated in this slide. So if we start from the genetic information, and so the DNA is somewhere defined at a spatial scale of angstroms, and gene regulation is pretty slow, so it varies from seconds to minutes. Furthermore, you have the cell physiology and the tissue physiology, and these physiological processes are relatively very fast, but are also defined at much larger spatial scales. Then you have the whole biomineralization process, in which all kind of complicated biocrystals are being formed, and this is again defined at a larger scale in time and in space. And finally, we would like to understand a kind of growth form which is defined on a scale of centimeters and meters, and which is developing in many years. And of course, if you are interested in evolution, you still should think about millions of years. Now, if you want to understand growth and form, starting from the molecular data, in fact you have to go across a kind of astronomical difference in scales in time and in space. So it's a major issue to develop a model for this kind of process. Now, I would like to start in fact with this level, the tissue physiology. So we would like to understand the kind of chemical processes going over there, and then I would like to link these kind of processes again with the emergence of macromorphologies and the influence of the whole environment on this process. And on Friday I would like to talk about these levels, about linking gene regulation and the movement of cells. Then the first topic is understanding the calcification physiology. And for this purpose, we used experimental data and we used a kind of a simulation approach. It's a kind of model which we are developing in collaboration with the Oceanographic Institute in Monaco, together with Denis Allemand, who is actually a world leading specialist in coral physiology. And the aim of this computational model is to understand this calcification process and the role of the photosynthetic process in this calcification process. And of course, just like Sebastian, we're also very interested in the influence of changing CO2 levels in the atmosphere and temperatures on the calcification process. Now over here you see a kind of a diagram of the first layer on top of the skeleton. And it's maybe important to be aware that if you have the skeleton, you have in fact four cell layers. And there's a space between these two cell layers. And over here you see the cell layer on top of the skeleton. And several processes are going on over here. So over here in this picture, it's depicted that you have transport of calcium ions over the cell layer. And over here, sufficient calcium ions are being collected. So you have a sufficient high concentration and you get deposition of calcium carbonate. The transport is going on to this kind of a transporter, which is known as calcium ATPase. And this process requires energy, so it requires ATP. And in exchange for a calcium ion, two protons are being exchanged. And the cell has to get rid of this kind of additional protons again. So there are all kinds of things which should be arranged in this process. This is actually one hypothesis, how this transport of calcium ions is supposed to go on. So there are actually two hypotheses. So the first hypothesis is that the transport of calcium ions is going across the cells. So that's the so-called intracellular transport. And another hypothesis, which is also around in coral biology, is that paracellular transport is a very dominant process in calcification. And if you talk with coral biologists, it's almost a kind of religious discussion, which hypothesis is right. Especially, for some reason, some geologists believe that paracellular transport is a major process in the calcification process. And I will come back later on to this. So over here you see in a kind of a diagram, again, those four cell layers. So at the left, you see the transport of calcium ions over the four cell layers. And at the right, you see the transport of bicarbonate over the four cell layers. And then you end up in a very narrow space between the skeleton and the last cell layer. And you need sufficient concentrations of calcium ions and bicarbonate to get calcification. So you can see that there are all kinds of transporters involved. And furthermore, what's important that in this layer, the so-called oral endodermal layer, you have these kind of elements, which are the symbionts. And the symbionts are in fact competing with the calcium deposition process because they use CO2 to convert CO2 and water into sugars. The actual calcification process is taking place over here in this layer. Now for the transport of calcium, you need energy, so you need the action of mitochondria, so you have respiration, and they are producing CO2 again. So over here in the actual calcium deposition, there's a kind of sink of CO2, and over here in the zooxanthellae, or the symbionts, there's another sink of CO2. Then we are very interested in all kind of new data which is coming available about the calcification physiology. So our colleagues in the Oceanographic Institute in Monaco, they're currently making this kind of beautiful pictures. So what you see actually on this picture is one of these cells over here, which contains, in this case, two symbionts. You can see that the symbionts are really cramped in the cell. They have very little space, and in this cell they have visualized the pH. So what you see in this picture is that you have a relatively very high pH if you are in the neighborhood of those symbionts. So this is actually evidence that the photosynthetic process is really actively influencing the pH internally in the cell. Then the kind of things in which we are interested. So we would like to capture this kind of spatial temporal behavior of the calcification process. We would like to make pictures which we can compare to this kind of intercellular imaging techniques. So by the way, on the previous picture, I have shown a picture of visualizing the pH in the cell. You can do a similar kind of thing and visualize, for example, the concentration of calcium ions in cells. So you have currently all kind of beautiful data available. So for this reason, we need to go to a model which also has a spatial dimension. So if you usually see models from systems biology, they're usually based on sets of ordinary differential equations, and usually this kind of spatial dimension is neglected. So this makes this model also a little bit more special. Of course, we also would like to test different hypotheses in our model. So we would like to test out the first hypothesis. Is intracellular transport important, or is paracellular important? Cellular transport a more dominant process? And we are also very interested in explaining the relation between calcification and the photosynthetic process. And of course, what's the influence of external parameters, for example, a changing pH? Now, the model, it consists out of a certain geometry, and it has a certain kind of scale. We model everything in space, so we need to go to reaction diffusion equations. You already have seen that the transporters are an important element in the model, so we also need to model the transport steps. Of course, we have to deal with the whole carbonate chemistry. We have to deal with the photosynthetic process and with the calcification. Over here, you see this part of the tissue like we represented in our computer. So it has the real scales, which you also observe if you would make a microscopical slice to a piece of coral tissue. So over here you see the first two layers of tissue. These first two layers of tissue contain the symbionts, which you see over there. And over here you have the two other layers of cells. And in this space, the actual calcium carbonate deposition is taking place. And so we have different compartments in our model. We follow the whole process in a time scale of a diurnal cycle, so a dark light cycle. And sorry for these equations, but this is the way how we represent the chemical reactions in our system. We use coupled reaction diffusion systems. So we follow the change of a certain chemical agent in time due to diffusion, due to reaction with all the other chemical species. And we can also add a transport step in this whole process. And this is a kind of conceptual outline of the model. So we have the different compartments. So this is the seawater, the environment. This is one layer of tissue. And this is the space between the layers of tissue. This is the other layer of tissue. And this is the space where the actual deposition of calcium carbonate is taking place. In all these different compartments, you have the kind of chemical reactions involved in the carbonate chemistry. In this layer of tissue, you have the photosynthetic process going on, and you have to where CO2 is converted into sugars. And over here you have the actual deposition of calcium carbonate in this layer, between the last tissue layer and the skeleton. Then the way how we represented the different transporter steps in our model. We used the Michaelis-Menten equations, which are frequently used in systems biology to represent all kinds of biochemical reactions. And so there's actually a difference between active transporters and channels and pumps in this kind of system. And just to indicate where you have the different transporters. So over here, on this picture, you see the five compartments again. So the seawater, the first two layers of tissues, the space between the two layers of tissue, and then the two next layers of tissue, and then finally the space where the actual calcium carbonate deposition is taking place. So the blue objects represent the transporters. So you have different transporters, channels, pumps, and exchangers. And of course, we also allow for paracellular transport. And on this slide, you see the different reactions involved in the carbonate chemistry. And fortunately, these processes are studied pretty well, so we have all the rate constants which we need to model this kind of system. And then another important element is the photosynthetic process. At this moment, we still have a very simplistic representation of photosynthesis in the whole process. So we have a kind of a certain function over here, which allows a certain kind of maximum photosynthetic rate, which is actually dependent on the amount of light which is being captured. And we are using a kind of diurnal rhythm. So we have a period with a lot of light, and we have a period in which it's dark and it's becoming light again. And this we use as a kind of input in our calcification model. Then the calcification itself. Now, if you look at all the other work about the proteomics involved in the calcification process, it's an extremely simple representation of calcification. And we simply use this kind of deposition reaction. In reality, this process is much more complicated. But this is the way we currently represent the calcification. And now to summarize everything, so we have different chemical species which are allowed to move to our multi-compartmental system. All the concentrations in the model are coupled by reactions, and there's no central regulation mechanism in this model. Now, the first result is that we now can make spatial pictures depicting the concentrations of the important ions in our calcification model. So over here you see the different cell layers, and over here you see the concentration of calcium. And this is a kind of picture in which we have the right concentration of calcium ions to get a deposition of calcium carbonate. Over here you see a kind of similar picture showing the pH. Again, we have the right value of the pH to allow for calcium carbonate deposition. And the second result is that we can couple this kind of chemical reactions now with the photosynthetic process. So we can now do different experiments for different maximum photosynthetic rates. And as input, we use the diurnal rhythm. And then we over here in these kind of pictures, you see the rate of calcification. Now, these kind of pictures might look pretty simplistic, but we were very happy that if we put all the chemical reactions together, that we could really get this kind of calcification rates. Because it demonstrates that we are in the right direction. Then we were still interested in testing out these two different hypotheses. So in our model, we allowed now for paracellular transport. So over here, in this case, you see two neighboring cells, and we allow some space, and we allow transport in a paracellular pathway over this cell layer. And the thing that you see happening immediately, if you allow this kind of paracellular transport, that you, in fact, destroy all these kind of gradients, and you don't have the right concentration anymore to get the calcium carbonate deposition. If you allow more paracellular transport, for example, between all the different cells, you don't have the right concentrations anymore to get the deposition of calcium carbonate. And so this result shows that our model is in favor of the first hypothesis. And it shows that if we allow for paracellular transport, that you in fact start inhibiting calcification. And so with this way, we could test out our different hypotheses. First of all, you should also be aware that this is a first highly simplistic version of the calcification process. We are still trying to improve this model and try to make it more biological realistic. One other thing which we discovered while developing this kind of model is that we also need some kind of additional proton and bicarbonate pumps to get the right concentrations to facilitate the precipitation of calcium carbonate. Then the next step is that we would like to go one level higher, and we would like to link the calcification process and the growth of the coral with the physical environment. And then you should think about hydrodynamics, light, and concentrations of dissolved inorganic carbon. In this example, we used in this topic, we used this coral from the Caribbean area as an example. You see over here three samples from the same species, Madrasus mirabilis. And the three samples were collected at different depths. So this is a typical sample from a shallow location. And this very thin branching form is from a more deeper location. And so you can see that the growth process of this coral is very plastic. There's a very strong influence of the physical environment on the growth process of these corals. And this picture demonstrates the growth process in a branching coral. So over here you see radiographs of slices made to a branching coral. And the kind of thing what you see on this picture is that during the growth process, all the time, layers of calcium carbonate are deposited on top of the previous layers. And from a kind of computational point of view, the nice property of this kind of growth process is that after this deposition process, basically the growth form doesn't change anymore. So you just deposit material on top of the previous layers. Then a kind of a surface view of a coral. So over here you see a surface in which you have removed all the living tissue. And you can simplify this kind of construction of coralites. You can simplify it as a kind of polygonal pattern that you see over here. So you can represent in a computational model every coralite by a kind of polygon, which you see over here on the picture below. So now we can make a kind of a simplification of this whole kind of growth process, is that we now imagine that we have a branching growth form. We can represent every growth layer by a kind of tessellation of polygons. And here all the time in the growth process, you deposit one layer on top of the previous layer, and you don't change the previous layers. Now, the whole idea of the growth model is that we have a three-dimensional simulation box. So from the source plane, the top plane in this three-dimensional box, we release simulated nutrients, and then you can think about inorganic carbon. Then this kind of simulated nutrient is being distributed in this simulation box by a combined process of diffusion and hydrodynamics. Then we have the simulated growth form and all the simulated nutrient, which is coming close to this simulated growth form, is absorbed at the surface of this object. And when there's more stuff absorbed, you will also have a local higher growth velocity. Furthermore, we can combine this idea with light. And light is needed for the photosynthetic process. We assume that light is corresponding to the vertical. And you can also allow more growth when locally more light is being captured at the object. Of course, you have to take care that, for example, this branch can shade another branch. So you have to take care that you also compute the shading of an upper branch on top of a lower branch. And then about the distribution of this kind of simulated nutrient in this environment. And so you can, when you assume there's no flow going on in the environment, you can try to model the process as kind of diffusion process. Then you need to solve this kind of equation. And if you also include flow, you have to go to more complicated partial differential equations, the Navier-Stokes equations. Now over here you see an example of a simulated growth form. In this case, we started in the three-dimensional simulation box with a spherical object, which you still can see over here. Then we distributed simulated nutrient in this simulation box, in this case by a diffusion process, so there's no flow involved in this example. And then in the growth process, we start depositing layers on top of the previous layers. And over here you see a section to this kind of object, and you can see all these kind of layers in this kind of growth form. The nice property of this type of growth model is that it has branching as a kind of emergent phenomenon. So there's no specific branching rule in this growth model. So the branching is really an emergent phenomenon from this simulation model. And you can explain the branching process by assuming that if you have a certain tip at a certain moment of the growth process, then if it slightly flattens, and that means that two parts of the object will get relatively a little bit more food compared to the other parts of the object, and you will have a kind of local increase of the growth velocity, which is enhancing itself, and this will cause the tip splitting in the object. So this kind of processes explain the branching in this model. Then over here you see one of our pictures of our zoo of simulated growth forms. So over here you see an object which was actually grown under diffusion limited conditions. So there's no yet any hydrodynamics involved. Then in this direction we added a parameter which is representing translocation of simulated food over the simulated growth form. So you should imagine that that you are somewhere at the surface of the object. Some food is locally captured by the simulated growth form, but now we also allow some kind of surface diffusion over the surface of the simulated object. And if you increase this parameter, this surface diffusion, in this direction, you finally go from branching forms to more massive growth forms. And here you see an experiment in which we still added a light to the growth process. So now the growth process is being controlled by a combination of light and capturing of simulated nutrient from the environment. And then you get branching forms like this, which tend to grow upward, but because light is now also limiting, you have suppression of growth in the lower branches. And this is the reason you get this kind of wedge-shaped objects. And finally, some example in which we also included the influence of hydrodynamics on the growth process. So over here you see a kind of diagram, a kind of morpho diagram, in which we varied two parameters in our growth model. So over here on the y-axis you see a diffusion coefficient. If we lower the diffusion coefficient, in fact, you increase the influence of hydrodynamics on the growth process. And over here, on the x-axis, we have yet another model parameter, which represents the saturation of food capture by the simulated object. And the typical effect, what you see, is that if you increase the influence of hydrodynamics on the growth process, you basically get more compact growth forms. Then we made a next step. So then we also made three-dimensional images of real corals and by using a computer tomography scanner. And we made three-dimensional reconstructions of those kind of images. And then we put everything together on one slide. We put simulated objects together with visualizations of real objects. And then, actually, I've shown this picture already to quite a few coral biologists, and the question to the coral biologist was, can you decide which of these objects are real or which are simulated? And I don't know if any one of you has a kind of idea which of these are real or which one are simulated. Any clues?
We can vote.
The bottom left. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, who is more in favor of bottom left? You too. Yeah. Okay. That's funny because that's typical choice which is done by most of the coral biologists, and so they always vote for the left bottom object, because it looks a little bit more irregular, so the way of thinking is, it looks a little bit more irregular, so it should be real. And so the funny thing is that only this object is a visualization of a real coral, and the two bottom objects only exist in a computer. And just to demonstrate this, so here you see the simulation of the left bottom object. And so we can reconstruct completely the growth process in a movie, because we have preserved all the growth steps. Unfortunately, we are not yet able to do this for the real object, so the only thing that I can do with the real object is to rotate it. We would be very interested if we could also reconstruct the growth process in a real object. We also are working on this problem, but I don't have real good results yet of this. Now, of course, this is only a visual comparison. If you show this to real scientists, they always will answer that, yeah, you should quantify this kind of results. So we also put a lot of effort in trying to quantify this kind of results. And again, have we used computer tomography scanning as a method for this. The problem is, so the typical thing that you see in this kind of corals is that they make very complex branching shapes. And the usual way how morphometrics is being done in biology is by using all kind of landmark-based methods. And so, for example, we can compare these kind of fishes, for example, by comparing the position of the eyes and the fins, and you can compare this fish with this fish using a kind of landmark-based method. Unfortunately, that won't help us in the corals, because there are no fins, there are no eyes. So we had to look at different methods. And there are several methods around which you can use to compare this kind of objects. So, for example, a very crude method is estimating fractal dimensions of these kind of objects. So you have this kind of beautiful morphology, and you lump everything together in one number, and this gives you only very limited information. Maybe it in fact only gives you as much as information as I would tell you that this is a three-dimensional object and this is a three-dimensional object. And so in fact you would like to have more information about the morphology. So we also put a lot of effort in developing so-called local measurements to quantify the morphologies. Now the basic idea is shown on this slide. So over here you have on this left column you have the real corals again, the three-dimensional corals, which I also have shown somewhere on the first slides. This is our reconstructed three-dimensional image after doing the computer tomography scanning. And after this step, we simplified the three-dimensional object into a so-called topological skeleton. And the idea of the topological skeleton is that you have a branching object, and you try to find the medial axis in the system. That's how you, in fact, you preserve the topology of the object, but you condense the information into a kind of one-dimensional topological skeleton. And this in fact, I show this on one slide, but you should be aware that this was, in fact, the work of two master students, and finally of this PhD student, who actually took 4 years before we had a reliable method for doing this kind of things. Now, the nice thing about these kind of morphological skeletons is that you can connect them with all kind of morphological measurements. So for example, as soon as you have this kind of morphological skeleton, you can measure the thickness of a branch at all kind of points along the skeleton, so you can construct a kind of maximum disc at a certain kind of position, and you can measure the thickness of a branch. You can also use the morphological skeleton to measure the branching angles very precise, and you can also use this kind of morphological skeleton to measure the spacing between two endpoints of a branch. Now the final thing what we can do is, so we have all these kind of beautiful growth forms, And for example, in this, from these kind of growth forms, we can measure the branching thickness, and we can translate all these kind of beautiful growth forms into boring statistics, and we can compare them with each other. You can do a similar kind of thing also with different coral species. So in this picture, you see four closely related Madrasus species. So in fact, this is the species which I have been showing until now all the time. This is Madrasus mirabilis. This species is known as Madrasus decactus, and this one is known as Madrasus farensis. And this species is a recently described species, which is known as Madrasus carmavi. And this species, this is also known from genetic analysis, is probably emerged by a kind of hybridization process between this species and this species. And it has a very remarkable morphology. Now, if I show these kind of pictures to my colleagues working in Curaçao, they already can guess from the morphologies what kind of species it are. Yeah, but it's usually very difficult to capture this into words. So we were also very interested if we could quantify the difference between these different species. Now, the kind of thing what you can do with this kind of morphometrics is you can measure the thickness of the branches. You can measure the branch spacing. Yeah, so for example, in this case, the branch spacing is something like this. And you can determine the average branch thickness, the average branch spacing, and you can put every morphology into a kind of a morpho diagram. And so now we have, in this picture, this was done for the simulated objects. And so every point in this morpho diagram represents a certain kind of morphology. Now we can also do this with the simulated objects and with the real corals. So over here you see again a morpho diagram in which you see the branch spacing on the y-axis and the branch thickness on the x-axis. The black labels now represent simulated growth forms, and the blue labels represent this Madrasus mirabilis species. And the thing that you see on this picture is that our simulated objects in this diagram, they nicely seem to mix with the blue objects. They also come quite close to the red labels, which is another species. But for some reason, we are not able to simulate this kind of growth forms, the green labels. And of course, it's a very interesting question. What are we missing that we cannot do these kind of morphologies? Now, the other thing is, what you can do now is, you can make a kind of comparison between a genetic tree, so what you see here on the left side. So actually, this tree was based on DNA sequences. So we used a part of nuclear DNA and a part of mitochondrial DNA to make a kind of genetic comparison between the different species. You already see that if you make the kind of genetic comparison, you immediately see that there are already some problems. For example, this species, which is described by traditional methods as red, so it doesn't nicely form one cluster. You can do the same thing by measuring all the different morphologies by using this kind of quantitative morphometrics method. And the nice thing that you can see is that some of the corals nicely group together when you use the morphometric method. But you still can see that that there are a few problems. For example, here is a green species which is mixing up with this group of red species. And you should be aware that these trees are based on the same corals. So here we have analyzed coral colonies from which we also took DNA samples. So the samples which we are comparing here on a morphometric way are the same samples which are compared on a genetic basis. We also looked a little bit in detail at this sample, and this is actually an example of this species, which I told before that this is supposed to be a kind of species which emerged in the evolution by an hybridization process. And for this particular sample, we also had all the DNA available, and it appeared that in this sample that one of the alleles was completely from this red species. So that this green guy is ending up in this red group is in fact in the correct conclusion by this kind of morphometric analysis. Okay, then finally some conclusions and also some open questions. So with the spatial model of the calcification physiology, we now can test out several of the existing hypotheses about calcification. I think it's still a very highly preliminary model. We still would like to add much more biological realism into this kind of model. And we are really aiming for a kind of model which we can compare with all these kind of beautiful results from intracellular imaging. With the macroscopic growth models, we can generate morphologies which, at least in a number of cases, are virtually indistinguishable from real morphologies. For example, we can approximate this species quite well. For some reason, we are not able yet to capture species like this. And of course, we are very interested in the question, what are we actually missing? We can also use the results to make a kind of comparison between phylogenies constructed by a genetic method and by a morphometric method. And furthermore, the thing which we learned when we also were working on the calcification physiology model, but also when we were working in much more detail on the whole biomineralization process, is that there are still many gaps in the whole knowledge about the molecular biology of the physiology of calcification. Although everyone is talking about ocean acidification and the impact on ocean acidification on the coral reefs, for some reason this very fundamental biological knowledge is highly understudied. And if you look around what's known about it and what things are still missing about it, I was really surprised by this. So, for example, the whole molecular mechanism and how proteins are controlling the biomineralization process, I think that this is only something, this is only knowledge which has become very recently available. And in fact, by my knowledge, no one is still has any idea how these proteins in the biomineralization process are controlling the whole deposition of calcium carbonate. So we also still miss a lot of important information in this whole process. Then I finally would like to go I would like to acknowledge a few people. So over here you see a picture of Carolina Kronenberg, and this is Lotte Huisman, who helped in developing the spatial model of calcification physiology. And over here you see a picture of Noel Chinderpol, who has been working on the macroscopical model of growth and form of the corals. And unfortunately, I don't have a picture of Max Filatov, who also contributed quite a lot to this work. So, thank you for your attention.